And visa decisions too by Tony Burke, who seems to hide behind his department all the time, including when there are concerns about a Palestinian man let in, despite connections to Hamas and other terror organisations. Liberal MP Julian Leeser outlines his concerns.
Well, this is right, Chris. I think Australians know that every time Labor comes to government, when it comes to the immigration program, things go to custard. And the first duty of a government is to protect Australians, to keep them safe, to, in John Howard's words, decide who comes to this country and the manner in which they come. And this government needs to exercise absolute clarity in denouncing anybody who might have been brought here, who's ever been a supporter of a terrorist organisation, and cancel visas of anybody who's come here, who's part of a terrorist organisation. And it seems as though, according to reports in News Limited papers today, that the government under Mr Burke's watch has let in a person who has been a supporter of Hamas and who's organised in Palestine events with senior Hamas leaders, and somehow he comes to be here. Now, Mr Burke's basically hidden behind the advice of the Director General of Security. You know, if Peter Dutton were in charge, when Peter Dutton was in charge, he would have taken these things very seriously because he put first the security of our country. He'd be calling in his departmental secretary, he'd be calling in the Director General of Security and saying to them, how can this person be here? And let's make sure that they're gone as soon as possible. That's what Tony Burke should be doing.
Yeah, they've got to be proactive, not waiting on the media or the coalition to bring these issues to their attention. I want to go back to Parliament yesterday and get your thoughts on the what I thought was a dismal day for the country. Labor and the Prime Minister, look, each side tries to blame the other, but I very clearly see this as the Prime Minister's problem. He should have sought a bipartisan motion so that the whole country could stand together in commemorating the victims of October the 7th. But instead, we had the opposite. A horrible, divisive day. What were your thoughts on it, and are there any ongoing consequences?
Well, look, you're absolutely right, Chris. The Prime Minister should have taken leadership of this issue from the start. It was actually Peter Dutton that went to the Prime Minister with a draft motion which acknowledged the significance and the solemnity of the 7th of October, as we remember that dreadful terrorist attack that claimed more Jewish lives in a single day than any day since the Holocaust. We remember the barbarity, the rapes, the dismembering of bodies, the sort of complete disregard for the humanity of the victims and the fact that there are still 100 hostages remaining. That's what the day should have been about. The Prime Minister came back with some alternative forms of words, and then before an agreement had been reached, just went into the House and presented a form of words that our side of politics had very strongly communicated were just not acceptable to us. And I think that this was a terrible thing. If you want to achieve bipartisanship, and I've done this across many different areas of public policy with the other side, you look at the things you can agree on and you leave out the things that you can't agree on. That's what should have happened yesterday. But this was the Prime Minister trying to play political games with this issue, and I think that that's a tragedy. I think what we need in this country is statesman-like leadership that takes a moment to acknowledge this dreadful terrorist attack, just like we did 12 months on from September 11, just like we did 12 months on from the Bali bombings. I thought it was a sad and regrettable day that we couldn't have a bipartisan motion. And then when Peter Dutton later in the afternoon put forward the motion that that he'd originally put to the Prime Minister, they gagged debate and didn't allow us to put it. So I think all in all, it was a diminished day for politics, but that's entirely at the feet of the Prime Minister.
Yeah, it's very disappointing. You won't get that opportunity back again. Looking to the contemporary issues in the Middle East, though, I want to show you what the Prime Minister said to Kieran Gilbert in an interview earlier today about Hamas and the future. Have a look.
Hamas can play no role, but that's why when you speak about what a future state looks like, it looks like one which Israeli security can be assured, one where Palestinians have a right to live in peace and security as well.
Yeah, this seems so problematic to me, Julian. He just doesn't understand the situation. He says Hamas can have no role in the future, yet he seems to oppose every effort to eliminate Hamas. How will you get rid of them if you say they have no role in the future? And talking about Palestinians living in a peaceful, secure environment, that's what they had in Gaza up until October the 7th.
Well, that's right. And that's the tragedy of all of this. People have forgotten that in the Middle East, Israel was making a whole bunch of agreements with its neighbours. The Abraham Accords, a deal with Saudi Arabia, was in the offing. And it's because Hamas and Hezbollah didn't like the idea that the Israelis would do a deal with the Saudis. The Iranians didn't like that. That's why they went ahead with these October 7 terror attacks. And Labor is hostage to the far left here. It's hostage to some of its Western Sydney constituencies. And rather than actually taking a principled position based on our values, based on what has been the traditional position in Australian foreign policy on Israel-Palestine, and that is that you can't proceed with a two-state solution until such time as, you know, the Palestinian actors recognise Israel's right to exist, till they lay down the arms, and in the present context, till they've returned the hostages. And you can't have a future with organisations like Hamas and Hezbollah. And that's why yesterday in the motions we opposed so strongly mentions of a ceasefire there, because all the ceasefire will do is just allow Hamas, Hezbollah and Iran to regroup and reform and make it actually harder for them to be eliminated, which is what we need to do in order to have peace in Israel, peace in Palestine and peace in Lebanon. And we need Iran to be no longer interfering in other countries and be the great disruptor that they have been right across the world, and the great disruptor that they seem to be increasingly in this country, where we see the Iranian diaspora concerned about the Iranian officials going to meetings, and we see those dreadful pro-Hezbollah protests in our streets.
It's so clear, it's so obvious, it just makes you wonder why our government either can't understand this or pretends not to. Thanks so much for joining us, Julian.
Thanks, Chris.